and welcome to Talking Crass. We're back again. It's your favourite go-to film podcast. Beat, how are you?
I'm dying hard.
I like it. Good pun.
It's terrible.
No, I like the beat. I enjoyed it. We've just seen Die Hard, as you can imagine. And what we're going to do is address the film and have a bit crack about other things to do with 80s action.
Yippee-ki-yay, yes.
Oh, Bede, they're going to stop already. The episode's going to follow the usual track of not necessarily top five.
Welcome to the podcast, pal.
Then true or false trivia. Then some episode discussion, final ratings, and fan questions. Bede, intro to Die Hard, not necessarily top five, bare feet in film. Bede somehow finds himself trapped in a room full of glass, yes. Windows, and the terrorists just shoot
it's
for 5 minutes.
It's a 1980s high-rise, John.
Right, okay.
If there's not glass and silver everywhere, you've missed the fucking maze on
That's fair. It's a great point. Therefore, he's in bare feet in the film.
It actually probably says 1990s. I could be wrong.
Beat, do you want to take us away with your first one? Not necessarily top five, bare feet in film.
I've gone for a sensible one. It's Kill Bill.
Right.
Oh, technically, Kill Bill Volume 2.
Right.
Oh, crap. No, it's Kill Bill as well.
It's the first one when she gets out the...
Alright, well, that wasn't the original one I had.
Oh, okay.
We're going Volume 2 first.
Yep.
When she... Oh, well, spoilers. Rips Ellie Driver's fucking other eye out and drops it on the floor and squidges it in between her toe.
Oh, yes. Why has she got no shoes on at that point?
She has no shoes on because she got buried alive?
With no shoes on?
Or she takes the shoes
he
off.
He takes the cowboy boots off her, doesn't he?
No, she has a cowboy boots because she reaches in to get a cutthroat razor.
Right.
Kisses it. Slices her bonds.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then leaves the shoes in the coffin, I guess. They come off in the mud.
Okay, mate.
So there you go.
My one, mate.
It's also purely done just to get the shot where the eyeball squishes through
and
the toes.
And it's a good shot, to be fair.
Yeah, I like ridiculous graphic violence.
I'll hit you one, mate. Jaws.
So are we
at some point in Jaws is the main character got shoes off.
Oh, what I was going to say is, are you referring to the sharks having a thin type of boot made for it?
I'm talking about the main character, Bede.
Yes.
So Brody at one point of Jaws definitely has his shoes off.
Does he?
I think so.
Was he ever gone swimming?
Have you seen that picture of him though?
Jesus Christ, he made a wax, isn't he?
Wax Brody on the iPad, people. Sorry, you can't see it.
Well done.
Right, okay, Bede. Jaws, we're flying here. Your one.
Can we pretend that the choice he made was the actual shark itself? And just the fact that its fins don't have some sort of leather created
no,
boot
but
for
we're,
them?
We're getting into that.
Okay. Next one for me.
Okay.
Frodo.
I was going to say Lord of the Rings as well.
Is that not
fair
on your
enough.
List?
No, but I remembered it last minute.
I.e. any hobbit, I'll also include Gollum.
Okay.
Because he don't have any shoes on throughout the whole film. He's just one loincloth. Which in real life he wouldn't
have. How hard?
It's purely for a PG audience.
How hard are Hobbit's feet?
Oh,
have they got like gorilla
the
feet?
The calloused fucking bits out.
Like, is it like a gorilla's skin?
Well, I guess I. Like, I just think they've calloused. I mean, a human foot can callous enough to get in their position.
Oh, yeah, that's fair.
You know, you callous your
but
hands.
But you know, no matter how calloused your foot is, or your feet, sorry, you're not hopping everywhere.
Yeah. That's a great point.
If you went to a beach and you walked along stones, would that still hurt?
No, it's dead. It's hard tissue. Real fucking... No. What makes you feel? Fuck.
Nerves.
Nerves. There's no... like, it doesn't
touch...
Wait,
so the nerves are dead?
Well, they're alive underneath the tough skin.
What if they...
I could be wrong. I'm not the biologist, all right, John?
Okay.
On fucking hobbits.
Right, Beach, do you want to hit me with the next one?
Hit me with the next one.
Warrior.
Ah, how
Tom Hardy in the UFC.
Has he got bare feet or we're talking rats?
In the UFC, in the octagon, they've got bare feet.
Do they? Him is that a law?
Him and the other dude. Who's the other dude?
Was it a law when UFC first started up when they had, like, literally a fat guy fighting a chimpanzee?
That was always the
Did
law.
Did you see when they had, like, shoes on? They were like, huge shoes.
No,
just, it was like
boots.
It was like WWE level of, like, shit standard.
Steel toe cabs.
And they had, like, a guy had fucking boots on. He was just booting the life up this karate master.
Did you see, like, a small black belt dude versus... Like a
the
pro wrestler.
The black belt destroyed him.
No. He got absolutely killed.
Oh, man.
He got absolutely annihilated.
Life isn't like the movies.
No, he's like trying to do karate, but he just fucking sat on him and just started pounding his head in.
Wow. Just as a show, gladiatorial violence is... What was that?
Someone beeped outside.
Gladiatorial violence...
No, just keep going.
...is still relevant today. Right, next one for me, John.
Come on, mate.
John Goodman's portrayal of Fred Flintstone. Of course.
That's an excellent one to throw in, actually.
Thanks very much, John. It's a pretty obvious choice of top five, because I don't think anybody in the entire show wears shoes.
What?
Of the Flintstones.
In the Flintstones?
Yes.
Does this go back to our point of calloused feet? Because what would their feet be like?
What?
Would it be like wearing shoes?
Yes.
Okay, right, you've made your point.
Right.
Is it on me, Beat?
You'd go next.
Hellboy.
All right, fair play.
Do you know who I'm talking about? Hellboy wears boots, not him.
Hold on, Hellboy wears boots?
It does.
Hellboy wears boots?
Yeah, yeah. He's got leather pants and shoes.
So Hellboy in the movie wears boots. Hellboy in the comic books has...
Hooves.
Hooves.
Right, it's not Hellboy out of the films.
We have Abe.
It's Abe, the fish.
Abe Sapien.
He doesn't wear for shoes, does he?
Yes.
Does he?
I have no idea.
I don't know.
He's a great character.
Okay, Pete, have you got any more?
Last one. Aeon Flux, monkey hand feed.
What?
So, Charlize Theron in the worst sci-fi movie I've ever seen, apart from Ultraviolet with Mila Jovovich, which is kind of the same vein of film.
Aye.
There's a girl in it who's her mate, who has to kind of access or infiltrate a security system.
Yeah.
And she goes under a weird procedure where she gets the feet of a body chopped off and replaced with hands. She starts swinging around like a monkey.
That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard.
And then the
sounds like horror.
No, it's not at all. Then they have grass, which turns into like really sharp razor blades, and she lands on the grass and just pokes all of the grass shards through her feet.
That sounds minging.
It's stupid, honestly. It's dumb.
He's one for your beat.
Yes.
For £1 million, would you swap your hands for feet and your feet for hands?
Am I dead for life? Like, is that me done? Like,
for life? Can't... So you get £1 million,
yeah,
right?
Because then I'd bank it interest and then save up enough money for an operation.
We'll up the ante. £10 million, but you've got to have feet for hands and hands for feet.
Okay.
But
questions.
You've got £10 million in the bank.
Questions. Can I save interest up with the £10 million, make me 25%, and then make an operation happen where I get them rechanged round?
Do you know any operations where you can do that?
A kid recently got both hands amputated, and he's swinging baseball bats. I'm telling you. So, as long as I can have hands for hands, and then hands for feet, I'm okay. I can't have feet for hands.
While we're talking about hands...
I could run like a dog.
What about our favourite composer of all time? Hans
Danny
Zimmer.
Elfman.
Oh.
Oh, subversion joke.
Is it on me, B? Is it on you?
I mean, I'm finished.
Okay, I've got one more. The Revenant.
Fair play. I get what you're saying. When he hides in a horse, the horse has no shoes on.
No.
What?
The bear.
The bear has no shoes.
Bear feet. Did you like that beat or not?
Did not.
There's a look of disgust.
There is.
Anyway, that is not necessarily top five. Bare feet in film, people.
Grizz it.
Beat. Need to pat the scene. Beat, before going to true or false trivia, do you want to talk about Tommy Wiseau's The Room a little bit?
Well, John, right, people, am I giving an opinion? Because I want to get a bear joke in.
Non-spoilers. Can you spoil The Room or not?
You can't.
The
spoil
disaster
the, you
artist.
Can't spoil.
Can you spoil The Disaster Artist?
No, not really.
It's really just a bit autobiographical.
You can spoil the tone.
Is it autobiographical?
I guess so. Don't you?
It's like kind of mockumentary. Yeah,
but
yeah.
Based.
Anyway,
more.
We went to see it, dear people. We'll do a little segment on it before we went to True or False Trivia.
Okay.
What were your thoughts, B?
It was a Lord of Winnie the Pooh.
You didn't like it?
No.
I thought it was good. I enjoyed it. I thought it was funny. 6 out of 10.
We don't do tens, John. We do rating system.
It was definitely an Idris Elba.
It was definitely Bram Stoker Dracula acting.
Do you reckon?
100%.
I am... It was directed by James Franco, I think, as well.
No.
Was it not?
Not James Franco.
Was it not?
The other one who's got less talent.
Dave Franco.
No. Oh, James Franco is James Franco. I was thinking Dave Franco was James Franco.
I mean... I thought James Franco was brilliant in it. Dave Franco was
James Franco brilliant in it?
Yes, he played Tommy Wiseau perfectly.
I don't think he was.
I did not hit her. I did not.
Oh, hi, Mark.
So would you recommend the film to the members of Crasshalla to go and run to the cinema and see it?
It's a firm fucking no. Alright?
At least we only paid £4.50 to get in.
It tore me apart, John.
Cheap Tuesdays.
Cheap, 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 cheap.
I like what you did there. Well done.
Thank you.
Beat. We'll end on that one and we'll go straight into true or false trivia.
Hit us up. Let's go.
In this segment, I'm going to give some trivia to Beat from a popular movie website. But I'm also going to throw a couple of red herrings in there. Beat's got to guess which ones are right and which ones are wrong.
What noise do the bird red heron make, John?
Cheep, 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 cheep.
He's got it. He's on the wavelength, dialed into 1.5.
Beat straight into it.
First, Beat FM.
First bit of true or false trivia. Frank Sinatra was in talks to play John McClane.
False.
That's true. You're out of it straight away.
Oh my God.
And guess what, Beat? Since you don't use social media, and you hate everything it stands for, the followers of our Talking Crass Twitter account and I, Yorks threw that bit of trivia in and said that they'll get Beat out.
Brand spanking Yorks. Is this...
This is Yorks the legend.
I call him Harley Quinn. Because every time I see it pop up on my phone and ignore it and don't answer.
I think he's a big poker player.
Oh, there we go.
I'm sure I saw a tweet earlier on where he's like...
Well, guess what's a common...
Good day, I won a couple of grand today.
I didn't ask something. My brain associates his Twitter name or his handle with... We've seen the...
It's the cards. It's the
cards, obviously, Harley Quinn uses. Fair play, mate. I'm a poker boy and all.
Yeah, so Yorks threw that one in. I've actually got his real Twitter handle on now, so it's at Yox2814. Give him a follow, people.
Yes.
Top man, interesting bloke, loves tattoos, loves poker, and he's playing a guitar on his profile picture. Anything better than that?
What a fucking legend, no. So it's just a prerequisite to get into the halls, basically.
Yox, you were totally right. He didn't have a clue. So Beat, Frank Sinatra had bought the rights to play this character. What do you think? Could you see an old Frank Sinatra as John McClane?
You know, if I did it my way, I wouldn't have cast him.
Very
Jesus
bad.
Jesus fucking Christ.
Next one, Beat. So you're currently 0-1.
New York, New York.
The Nakatomi Tower is actually the headquarters of 20th Century Fox. The company charged itself rent for the use of the then unfinished building.
You are the most fucking useless... False.
True, Beat.
What?
0-2.
Yorks? God damn yeah. it. Is it Yorks again?
No, these are all mine
Jesus
now.
Jesus Christ.
The Nakatomi Tower was actually bought and was the headquarters of 20th Century Fox, Beat.
Really? Bought after the film or before? Does a popular website not name...
As the film was being... filmed, they had it, I think.
Well done. Makes sense to me. Not at all.
People, like you know, we're useless. Do your own judge on this one.
Try and work out what he's just said.
Beat, next one. If you cut your feet like McClane did, you would pass out due to blood loss within 30 minutes.
False.
That's false. You want to.
Yes.
To be fair, he goes straight to a toilet and wraps them up, doesn't he? So I don't know where I got that bit of you
exactly.
from.
I mean, I'm thinking femoral artery.
Do we speak?
Nothing near there.
Do we speak about when there's like a million bullets going in them glass panes or not?
We'll speak about that later.
Okay.
Can I just bring up a point?
Of course you
can. We evolved to walk on feet.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe people who walked on sharp objects and had all the veins in the feet died, and that's maybe why we didn't evolve with femoral arteries in our feet, John.
Do dogs have feet or hands?
Paws, I believe, don't they? Is a paw the equivalent to a palm? Or is a paw the hand? Or is the paw the arm? Or is it a completely individual biological
element? You've got the Big Bang, and then you've got, do dogs have hands, legs, or paws?
Paws, yes.
Sorry, feet, not legs, they've got legs.
They've got legs. Oh, have you seen that thing on Twitter where they wonder how you dress a dog? Whether I don't think you should ever dress a dog. I'm not going to judge you if you do. But people on Twitter debate...
It overheats the dog, doesn't it?
I think it does. But that's... I mean, if you're not overheating the
dog... I'm all for people getting a mane and putting it on a dog so it looks like a lion.
Of course. We're so hypocritical.
Right, okay.
When you put jeans on a dog, does it go across the chest to the arse? Or does it go around the waist? Do you know what I mean? So is it an X, Y axis or a Y axis? Do you get what I mean?
A dog with jeans on.
So would the jeans fit on all of its legs?
Like dungarees?
Hind? Yes. Right, okay. Or on the hind? So imagine that's the body. 50%
You'd put it on the back legs?
You'd definitely put it on the back, 100%. Wouldn't you? Yeah.
1,000,000%.
Yeah, got it.
It would be like putting your jeans on your arms.
I get it.
Okay. Where were you putting your feet here?
I don't know. True or false trivia? Dogs and jeans.
Next one, babe. Kerry, 1-2. Bruce Willis received a then unheard of $5 million. A fee that was approved by Fox president Rupert Murdoch.
I'm sorry, right? I've been trying there just while you were talking to think up a joke which incorporates Levi and the dog breed. Haven't thought of it yet. Get back to us, people.
Yeah, so later on.
Repeat what you just said because I wasn't listening.
Bruce Willis got $5 million for playing John McClane.
$5 million?
Unheard of at the time.
I have no idea or concept of how much actors get paid.
That was a lot of money back then.
Okay.
Agreed by Rupert Murdoch, who was the Fox CEO at the time.
Now, I don't know what people's opinions are.
There's only one reason I've thrown this bit of trivia in.
Why?
I saw Rupert Murdoch.
What?
And I want you to go on a tangent about it.
You saw Rupert Murdoch?
Written.
Oh, you saw it down.
I didn't see him fucking walking through where we live.
I mean, does anybody like him?
I think.
Does anybody like him?
In my opinion, he's one of the world rulers. He rules the world.
So he's one for you?
Like, ridiculous. He's got a ridiculous amount of I was going to say money. He's got a ridiculous amount of money, but he's got a ridiculous amount of...
We shouldn't get into politics.
No, but what's the word I'm looking for?
Control.
Yeah, just control over...
He's a stat for you, John. Owns 75% of all media outlets in Australia.
I mean, where does that equate to the world?
You know the idea where you create a free media source where they create opinions and
closed borders? Are we talking about closed borders and stuff like that?
I'm talking he can print what he wants to 75% of Australia. Interesting.
The truth to
a
people is don't believe what you read in the media.
Don't read anything. Just believe us. Dogs wear jeans, all
right? Exactly, yeah. The scene where McClane falls down a shaft was a mistake by the stuntman.
Rupert Murdoch, am I right?
Who was supposed to grab the first vent, as it was originally planned. He slipped and continued to fall, but the shot was used anyway.
100% correct.
It was edited together
with
one where McClane grabs the next vent down.
Absolute mastery. I've seen a YouTube video. It's 100% true.
It's true,
I know it is.
And how good does it look?
It looks fantastic.
It looks brilliant.
I pointed it out when I was in the cinema. Well, not cinema. Screening in the old house arena.
Beat. For the shot where Hans Gruber falls from the top of the building, Alan Rickman was actually falling from a 21-foot high model.
That's true.
He was holding onto a stuntman and falling onto an airbag. To get the right reaction, the stuntman dropped Rickman on the count of 2 instead of 3.
I've also seen another YouTube video on it. It's completely true.
That's unreal, lad. 1, 2, unreal, I love that. That's like people do that when you're going for like a skydive.
So, you know, it's like,
you've got to be fucked up to do that.
Like
someone,
when
haven't you?
You cut the bit wire off
like
and throw
bungee,
it off after them.
Like a bungee.
Knobheads.
When have you ever seen someone cut a bit of wire off and throw it off?
I watch a lot of YouTube videos, if you haven't guessed.
What do you do? What do they do?
They throw the person off and then, you know, the hook that hooks them to the actual foundation? They throw it off. So they can, like, no.
Fucking hell.
Incredible.
I don't get it. I don't get that. I don't know how that can entertain someone.
No, me neither. Why would you ever put yourself in that position?
I would lose sleep over it.
Why would you ever put yourself in that position, John?
The original script included a Mexican cartel instead of German terrorists.
Uh-oh.
The lead character was to be played by Danny Trejo and be called Victor Nunes Marcellez.
True.
False.
Oh, I'm so racist.
I'm murdering.
I'm vicariously racist by answering true to that, am I? Well, there's a point I bring up, which I've made later on the film about the
German... Is your point Danny Trejo in any film is a good film?
No, the point is the...
Is he called Danny Trejo?
Danny Trejo, machete.
That's the one, yeah, that's the one.
Next point. Finish?
You're going to say something there.
What I was going to say is, I convinced myself there because there's a point I've made later which is associated with that point.
How good would it be if this was a Mexican cartel?
Yes, exactly. Think how? I don't know.
And B, that wraps up true or false trivia, mate.
Well done. I really didn't perform there, did I?
No, you didn't.
That first might be two, your worst showing ever. Out the arse.
That might be your worst showing.
I blame Rupert Murdoch.
I'll tell you what it is, though, B.
Have you thought of a Levi jeans dog breed? Levi, how does that work? Come on. Levi.
Anyway, B, you'll be glad to know we can now go into film discussion.
Bing, bang, boom.
A.K.A. Beat's Point.
Let that go.
In this segment, we run through the film. It's beneficial if you watch the film before.
Granted.
Pretty much before or after you've listened to the podcast, but we go through each point in a chronological order of the film viewing.
Thank you very much.
Beat.
Yes.
Take it away.
McClane's wife tells heavily pregnant woman to drink champagne.
Is this going to be one of these episodes, Beat, where you've made 40 points?
Yes.
Or not? Yes.
No, just 10.
Pregnant women are allowed to drink a little bit,
No,
Beat.
Definitely more. Are they?
Yep.
Okay. Moving on. Did you know, right, if a pregnant woman drinks, the alcohol goes to the booze, and when the breastfeed the child, they kind of have a bit of alcohol in there.
Really?
I could be completely wrong.
I think that's sure if you have like 10 cans of Stella, though, not
I
like...
I spoke to a woman about it.
You spoke to a woman?
A woman, how? A woman. Rare in my experience.
Next point, mate.
Argyle is a fucking ledge.
Love Argyle. What limo driver, beat, would wait in that situation all day?
One on his first job.
I know.
There you go.
And did he just do it because he enjoyed the limo that he was driving?
I think he's just a fucking legend.
I mean, fair enough.
He's getting ready to go. He's a bumping up at the morning. I love that song, though. Bow, 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 bow. Love basic visual storytelling. References to this. John McClane's bumped in the airport.
Mm.
You know what? He's looking about. He's seeing chicks dive on ski guys. Wearing lycra pants. He's like, whoa, fucking...
Peas Brosnan pants or not?
He's a fish out of water, mate.
Right, okay, mate.
Gets in the front of the limousine, rather than the back.
Just
completely... Without just any like exposition. Guy. Simple stuff. Subtle. But it gives us... As an audience member...
Straight away, there's something up.
You're like, this guy is old-fashioned, takes no shit from nobody, and he doesn't like these goddamn millennials coming in and ruining his... Christmas party.
I like it, Bede. We hate millennials.
They're not millennials, though. They're my generation, because we've gone back in time. Alright?
Okay.
What's the other one? Also, the fact that his wife changes her last name. A great indication. Yes. You don't need to go... Although it does happen a little
straight
bit
away
later.
Straight away, you know something's up.
Exactly. I like it a lot. It's very subtle.
So, what's happened to these subtle...
Subtlety.
What's happened to this in film? Do you think it's like what we said? Do you think people now... The directors and... producers and people who are in the boardroom think that people viewing the film are stupid.
Not stupid, they just maybe need the need to kind of just explain everything anyway, cover your bases kind of thing.
I don't know, I think Hollywood thinks we're stupid
and
now.
And this is Die Hard.
That's a feeling I get in the last 10 years of
film. This is Die Hard where guns are everywhere, there's action every 5 seconds, it's a male macho lead, you know.
Yeah, fair.
But there's still that subtlety, even in this. And this is why I love these films, you know, your Aliens, your Terminator 2. It combines schlocky action, what you would attach with something that isn't artistic.
We're a solid
plot. Isn't artistic, a really solid plot with quite intelligent storytelling. I really enjoy it, mate.
And not...
Gets to me core.
And not 10-foot CGI villains.
Absolutely. I'd be so proud if I could make something like that.
Yeah, fair enough.
Ellis, the coke sniffer, is one of my two all-time favourite characters in the film. The others being FBI agents, who I class as one person, as they share the same name. Agent Johnson. Big Johnson and Little Johnson.
That's great in the credits.
Three characters.
We saw that in the credits, didn't we?
Yeah, we were laughing for the first time in my life.
What does he say when he's in the helicopter later on?
Just like Saigon! Like, he starts laughing.
I like how he puts it, just because he's a sniper, he puts the cap,
backwards. And then he goes like, was it? We're gonna bust in the roof, blow all the hostages. We can maybe lose 25% of them. I can live with that. My God. We've got a couple of points to bring up on that later, but okay. I'll move on. Hockey Puck. Segue into game nostalgia.
Right. So, I don't know whether you guys have played it, but there was A game that came out for the PS1.
Definitely PS1.
Called Die Hard Trilogy.
Was that it?
It was called Die Hard Trilogy.
My God.
So you've got Die Hard, where you play a third person. As
top down GTA?
Kind of, aye.
It was,
John McClane.
John McClane.
Where you throw these hockey pucks.
Yep.
And you pick up these MP5s.
And it was just in a parking lot, wasn't it?
In a parking lot, and you've got to make your way up each floor of the building.
Yes.
And then kill Hans Gruber at the end, I think. I don't know, I'm not too sure.
Unbelievable.
You've got the second one, which is the second Die Hard, which is a first-person shooter.
I know people are agreeing here, by the way, that have heard of this, because this is ultimate nostalgia
this
for
is
us.
It's a nostalgia trip.
Yes.
And then you've got the third one, which was the car. You drove a taxi.
Yeah.
Die Hard with a Vengeance.
Uh-huh.
Against, was there a time?
Just a timer, because
it's a time limit.
A nuke gonna gun off.
But if you did well, you got that police car, which was a great feeling. Like,
was that an automatic...
Blue and white? It was like a blue and white police car.
Was that every time you loaded up, you had like a 1% chance to get the police car?
I think you had to complete every trial at a certain level.
Right, and then
you
selected
the police
it.
Car, right.
Unbelievable. Overdubbed by Sam Jackson. Was correct?
Are you aiming for these people?
Oh my God. And it played like
every five seconds. Are you aiming for those people?
Oh my God, my childhood, how? My childhood.
Excellent. The hockey puck brought it back. On a side note, has that ever been used? Is it a real thing?
Maybe it got out surpassed by the grenade design?
Because
why would you want a hockey puck? To slide on laminate flooring? Because if you're in a muddy field, that's not helping
you're
me.
Right,
one.
You're right.
You know what I mean? Unless you're in ice.
Could you frisbee one of them hockey pucks? Longer than what you throw a grenade?
Why wouldn't you? Oh, I get what you mean. Like a little bit like of a, bit an of inertia, kind of. A little hook arm.
I think you could probably discus it longer than you could throw a grenade.
I would be minimal, though. To lose that bounciness of a grenade, which you can hide off a wall. You hide that puck at a wall, it's just going
to
fly.
And to be fair, it's only a flashbang, isn't it?
It is. It is.
All right. Moving on, babe.
Well, there's a reason we haven't seen it used practically in any sort of war from now on. Who knows? We don't get told anything, unless it's 50 years have surpassed. Our two members of security... classed as sufficient defence of a building this size and under construction. Granted, it is late Christmas Eve.
Why are they in there, Beat? Why are they having a Christmas party?
Right, who goes to a Christmas party on Christmas Eve from the work side of things? Am I going mentally? Am I shut in?
Does it happen? Maybe it's an American thing?
I couldn't hack that, like. I couldn't spend
You've
it with
You've got Christmas
people.
Eve... and they throw an office party, and...
You got a pregnant lass there?
And there's people like banging all over the building.
I mean, to be fair, there's tits everywhere. It's an action movie. You got to have tits in it, I guess. Boobies, as they say.
But getting back to a beat, no two security guards isn't adequate.
No,
enough.
Right.
Not at all.
Because that's all I saw. Well done, Nakatomi. You fucked that one up, didn't you?
Is he called Nakatomi?
No, he's called Takagami.
That's exactly what he's called, Beat, isn't
Brilliant.
It? Brilliant. Takagami.
Something like that. Takagi.
Takagi, right.
Well done, me. Hollywood logic. We got bad guys? Yep. Making German. That's in relation to the Mexico cartel.
So we had a like 5-minute conversation of, are these Nazis or are they just terrorists?
Well, Nazis is just our personal reflection on them as German people, because we hate all Germans, because they are all Nazis.
What?
What's that called? Oh, satire.
All Germans are not Nazis, people. It was a joke.
He gets it.
Anyone been to... I went to Dusseldorf the other year, last year.
Did you?
Best place I've been to.
Really?
Couldn't do enough for you.
Brilliant. Moving
but
on.
But back there, it was in the 90s...
Nobody cared
80s
what you had to
sorry,
say.
Sorry, 80s and 90s.
Excuse me, Hollywood. I am not accountable for the actions of people born before me. I don't care, motherfucker. You're the enemy.
All Nazis are enemy. And Beat, I'm what a good enemy they are.
They are. I agree 100%.
Okay.
How does Guy, in full grey, die from doing a roly-poly downstairs?
Beat, that's funny you got that right, because guess what?
What?
I've got... Love the guy who was in full grey jogging gear. Gone for functionality over style. Pity he has small feet.
Very good, very good.
You know what he reminded us of?
Who do you remind you of, Joe?
You.
Me?
Like, if you're in that terrorist situation...
I'm not blonde and I don't have glasses.
I know, but...
I wish I did.
If you were in that terrorist...
He's got great glasses, by the way. Sorry to keep him right.
If you were in that terrorist situation, Beat, you'd want him everywhere in that gear.
Oh, my God.
Grey straight down.
I might have a hood.
You probably have a grey hooded top on and yes. grey joggers.
Bang on.
And I mean, you know what? I'd be dressed like Neo. I'd have like, I'd have a leather duster on, jeans, you know what I mean? Black, full black suit.
You're exactly right.
And you know what? You'd probably win every battle because you're in full greys and you'd do roly polies. I'd
definitely not get me neck snapped. It looks so odd. I get the feeling that it was made after. Well, no, I couldn't have.
Did you know as well?
Yeah.
There was only two of the full cast of bad guys that were actually German. They were all picked on just the size and strength of the look of them.
I understand that, I guess.
Yeah.
Great representation of John's intelligence through him marking off names of the bad guys on his arm. That is, again, that touch of subtlety.
Where does he get the pen from, B?
I have no idea. Because this film's stupid.
And to get one of them black felt-tip pens which easily write on your hand.
And like, to keep it on like throughout the rest of the film. I write some down on my hands.
Even though the vest colour changes...
green.
The vest colour changes every bloody scene.
Absolutely.
It goes from white stained to brown to dark green back to white stained.
I like it. I like it. Again, it's that subtlety through showing the character.
Mm.
Visual storytelling. You know...
you can tell this guy's not just a
really
cop.
Clever. That's a really...
You can tell this guy's not just a cop, he's a detective.
He's not only marking off ones he's killed, he's trying to take names. It's just so great.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? First example of police incompetence, with the operators dismissing John's call for help.
Yeah, so you made a big point about this when watching the film.
Yes, I made it many times. Every time the police are displayed, other than Al Powell,
Sergeant Al Powell. What a legend.
They are completely incompetent, and it's a very, very deliberate choice, in my opinion. I haven't watched YouTube videos on it, I haven't Googled it.
Mm-hmm.
I feel the director is gone. I want to show how stupid the cops are.
Do you think?
Aye. That's or at fair. Least... he must
There's
have
got to be some sort of like deliberate...
He must be sending some sort of political or social message on his opinion on what the policing was done at that time. So,
what about when Sergeant Al Powell goes in for the Twinkies?
Unbelievable.
Do you think that's a kind of ode to that or not? Or do you think that's
I think Al Powell's a complete... He's the director's going, you're not all the same.
Right, okay.
They are good. You know what I mean? But it's just that bit where he's like, do you think I'm ordering a fucking pizza, lady? And he's getting shot at in the background. And they're like, yeah, send a black and white over. Absolutely ridiculous. How long is the belt of that MP5? Did you get the feeling it was like 2 yard?
I don't care, Bede, but what I will say is I've got loads of time in film for a buckle that's just coming loose.
Absolutely. What else are we talking about? Jurassic Park?
What's one with Sylvester Stallone in? Jurassic Park? What's one with Sylvester Stallone in when he's the rock climber?
Cliffhanger? Absolutely.
That happens a few times, you know, the ball just coming loose off the thing. I've got lots of time for that in film.
Okay.
Lots of time, Bede.
Great cliche, John. Great cliche. News incompetence is shown with the lead anchor. So again, just like the cops, again, I think it's repeated for news media. Yeah. The anchor, what does he do? He...
Throwing about the Helsinki...
He says Helsinki, Sweden.
it's genuine Helsinki syndrome. Helsinki,
that's
Sweden?
That's Helsinki, Sweden. and it cuts to the director. Like, that's a forehead slap. Brilliant. Idiot police chief highlights a second jab at police idiocy. This is the guy out of the Breakfast Club.
Yes.
Does Barry Manilow know you raid his wardrobe? That's the best impression I can do of the guy out
of
the Breakfast Club. He turns up and he's a complete fucking fool. My favourite thing in movies, SWAT without helmets and Vietnam M16s. You know it, John. We've got the lot.
That is... It's mentioned numerous times on this podcast.
Many times.
But his favourite thing is... FBI or SWAT that are wearing nothing but a cap, fingerless gloves, and an M16 from NAM.
Absolutely. Also, the one guy who's been unlucky enough to get a pistol and he's one-handed.
Do you know,
he's not even doubled up.
He's gone through shit, right?
Yep.
He's like, I'm going to have to nip this. Runs off, all the lads are coming out the back of the van with M16s.
He's like, oh, shit.
Fucks.
So you've got 80% M16s. One MP5, one shotgun, one pistol. That's it. And you see anything else?
Would you not just all grab shotguns in that situation? I'm sure if that was
all that up. How is that a good idea?
Why would you not SWAT? It's indoors fire.
You want fire rate, didn't you? You got to cock it. It's boom, boom. I mean, I'm not a fire guy. I've never
spread of a shotgun though.
I've only fired a hunting rifle. I've never fired anything else.
I went to Vegas once and I've fired a few different guns.
Did you? What did you fire?
I fired a Glock. believe it or not.
Interesting. Did you feel scared or
fired a sniper rifle?
Did you?
Nah, it's decent.
Aye.
A lot of kickback on the sniper rifle, like you don't realise it.
Right.
And what else? I fired an MP5 as well.
Did you? Full auto.
Very hard to control. Comes up like it just. You know
so you would have to pull down.
You've got aim down because the natural arc is Rambo. Upwards. You know what else worried us about that in Vegas when I went to the shooting range though?
Yeah.
There's nothing stopping you from turning around and shooting the person next to you.
Shooting someone in the head, that's scary, that like.
And also there's a Russian guy, he must have had some money, and a shit you not beat, he was on a minigun next to us.
Oh, no,
they rolled the minigun out and he's just...
Oh my god.
Absolutely annihilating the target.
I love when you've made your money and you're going, I'm going to a gun range and I'm getting a minigun.
God bless America.
The land of the free, mate. The land of the free and the brave, whatever it sounds like. Next point. For an action movie, the subtlety that is used is great. Hans facade. Again, it's more touches I'm talking about bringing up. Hans facade when he pretends to be American.
Do you know that was,
whole scene's do you know brilliant. Where,
that got added to the film.
Yeah.
Because
production
he was impressed with Rickman's accent, the American accent.
Right, right.
And he thought it would like obviously be better for both character arcs if they met each other like that.
Okay, yeah.
So it got added to the film.
So like, I
think I got added in post-production, actually.
That's interesting. I just like everything about it. You've got he racks the focus. It's got the gun at the end. He tries
the
to
point
lay
when
down
his
there.
Name that he makes up is on the side.
His name's on the side where Rickman's character can't see.
And Bruce Willis notices it, doesn't he?
Absolutely. It's so nice. He gives him the gun. Oh, my God. You know what's great to see in these films?
Yep.
The bad guy who thinks he's the most intelligent, well-planned-out, absolute mastermind... And fucking, they get stunted up and they look like a fucking fool. Me favourite thing. Oh, no bullets! You idiot! Rip the gun off him. Yes! We cheer in the crowd. My favourite. Question, John. Is it more of a western with the constant references to cowboys and other shit? Over a Christmas film.
Yippee-ki-yay.
Exactly. Roy Rogers. John Wayne. A lone gunman attacking a lot of bandits.
I like it.
Thieves.
Yeah.
We have the white hat.
It is. That
white
is
hat. John McClane. If John McClane doesn't sound like a deputy name, I've never heard anything like it before in my life. Hans Gruber's our black hat. Our Lee Van Cleef, mate.
Yes. I love it.
What do you reckon?
I absolutely love it, mate. I know he made Christmas references there. We'll go at that later on.
We'll go at that later. Other points. Ends the film with kind of Mexican standoff. Two bullets in a pistol.
Yeah.
It's not a full loaded clip. It's like that revolver, minimalist ammo. That kind of tension added by knowing you've only got 6 shots. I like it a lot. I love that shit. I love me a western, mate. Two films in... This is the final point, by the way.
Yeah, right.
Two films in a row that finish with the main villain falling to his death out of a skyrise glass window.
Which one was better, beat RoboCop or this?
Now, you think I'm going to say this.
Right.
But the fact that they made the directorial decision to change the actor to a clear 2-inch figurine with 5-foot-wide arms
wins it for me. Put 5-foot arms, mate.
All right.
I love the practicality of the Die Hard one, though. It looked very, very good.
Yes.
Do you think it stood the test of time as well?
That fall from window.
So
what green screen does in them times, it's like black outline. You can definitely see it. But I'll give it. It's a lovely effect. Bonus point, John. Love how in the credits sequence, separate part for the terrorist category. Label terrorist. It's just Hans Gruber.
Terrorist
then.
Hans Gruber fucking, and the rest down.
Again, I don't know if that's a joke. I guess it is. It's fucking brilliant.
I don't care, but I loved it.
That wraps it up, mate.
That's fair, mate. I've got one point to make at the end. How did the guy who got hanged by that chain come back to life right at the end?
Was that the same guy?
For Al Powell to shoot him. I'm sure that's the same guy.
Was that the same guy?
He comes out and Al Powell just blows him away.
I have no idea.
I think that's him, but he looked like he was dead on that chain.
He was German, he was 7 foot tall.
And he had blonde hair.
Long blonde hair. I don't know. Whether you can hang people like that, I do not know.
Anyway, Pete, that wraps it up. But before we go into final ratings, I want to make a little comment about someone on our Twitter.
Okay.
Top man, by the way. At Agro the Clown.
What a legend.
So what I did for Agro is pick out every part of the film that has a Christmas reference in.
Well, you try to.
I try to. So Agro's point was, Beat.
Yes.
What do you think about this? It didn't need to be Christmas for the film to take place and work as a plot.
Right.
What do you think of that?
He's on fire.
Okay.
End of the film.
It got some good conversation. Love them comments. Keep giving us them. Agro, you set off a nice conversation on our Twitter, and I enjoyed it.
1 point. Why are they in the Nakatomi place? Oh, well, doesn't it need to be set at building? Wow, I can't speak. John, he's a fatal flaw in Agro's argument.
Okay.
It's Christmas wrapping tape that he uses to tape the pistol at the back of his...
Yes! So he would never have killed Hans Gruber if it wasn't Christmas.
There's absolutely no way there would be normal tape in an office building.
Right? None whatsoever, Pete.
The fact that it's
none
a Christmas
whatsoever.
And it has holly and mistletoe on is the reason he taped it to his back. I rest my case.
Baker, sorry. Can I just go back into the points before we go around these Christmas references?
Go for it.
How good was that explosion at the end?
The one where he drops the 5 pounds of C4 down the elevator shaft.
Do 5 pounds of C4 make an explosion like that?
I don't know.
So it was like a nuclear blast.
It was.
And also, how did he not know that it would harm the hostages? Because he literally blew off the bottom of the building.
I have and absolutely
probably,
no idea.
Weren't they on the bottom of the building, the bottom floor?
I think so. No, they weren't.
But they must have at least blew up like 3 floors above them.
Were they on the 30th?
Oh, maybe that's why then. Would that not destabilise
the
building?
How does the helicopter land into that?
I've got no idea, but in true 80s style as well, another point we've missed.
Yes.
How low do them helicopters fly?
Oh, fucking brilliant.
They're like 5...
The real shots,
like,
aren't they?
Yes, yeah, they're like 10 foot off the ground flying through buildings. I've got no idea, mate.
Unbelievable.
Right, Agro. Here's some references to show it's a Christmas film. Die Hard title, accompanied by bells. It's a Christmas film.
It is absolutely necessary.
Who has a Christmas party at the office on Christmas Eve, by the way? It's a Christmas film.
There's no other reason that the people could be put in that situation.
Run DMC Christmas song.
Is that
a Christmas film.
Is that validated?
It gets played when he goes into the limo.
Was it Run DMC?
Yes, it was.
It couldn't be any other song.
Whistling the Christmas theme on numerous occasions.
If it was set at any other time, the film wouldn't work.
Bad Guy's theme tune is a Christmas song.
They couldn't make an original soundtrack. It had to be Christmas themed.
Hans Gruber hums the Christmas song on numerous occasions.
Well done.
Ho ho ho, now I have a machine gun.
This film definitely could have worked as not a Christmas film.
I think I'm actually proving myself wrong here.
We have.
Numerous Christmas trees.
They could be taken out.
Oh no. 'Twas the Night Before Christmas reference.
Okay.
US mail Christmas present.
What?
I don't know why I've got that point.
What's
down.
What's that gone down about?
Ends with Let It Snow.
That's absolutely fucking stupid as fuck.
So in true style, Agro, I proved you wrong.
Right, Agro, it's more of a western. It really is. Oh my god. Right, he's one for you.
Okay.
Being serious.
Yeah.
What stipulations have to be met for it to be a Christmas film?
Right.
For a western, can I butt in?
My point was, if it wasn't Christmas Eve, would he not be going home to see Holly?
No, another plot...
Agro said, well, is he not just going to see his estranged wife?
Another plot device. Exactly, you could just have that without it being set. A point I was going to make is, for a western, obviously people have tried to theorise what literally gone through in the scientific equalisation of what am I even talking about? People have tried to work out exactly what makes a western as a genre. Basically, it kind of boils down to, rather than white hat, black hat, it's more so civilization versus savagery.
Right, okay.
That's it. That's what makes a western. All other things are secondary. There's a lot of other stuff. It has to be set in America.
Dude, Hans Gruber's wearing an expensive suit. How's he a savage?
What makes a Christmas film? Because it works differently.
Bells, Christmas trees... and US wrapping paper.
You know what I mean? Is it like festive joy or... It's more so setting, really, isn't it?
But then, could you not see Home Alone if took place, I don't know, on Thanksgiving Day, it would be a Thanksgiving film.
I don't think any Christmas film is a Christmas film.
If you take Christmas out of it.
If you take literally the setting of Christmas out of it.
There you go, people. Home Alone's a Western. Moving
Boom.
On. Beat straight and final rating.
It's a subgenre. It works.
Let me know what you thought.
Agree
of Die Hard.
Agree, disagree, I grow.
Always.
I'll always like you.
Love the support. What do you think your final rating, the Beat?
Final rating Die Hard. What else could I give it than goddamn Crasshalla verification?
And the halls of Crasshalla Die Hard. We're having a good time recently. Robocop Die Hard.
It's getting closer to Christmas, John. We're trying to give ourselves a nice, easy run-in to a nice little film coming up. Getting screened this Friday.
We'll talk about that after the final ratings, Beat.
Okay.
So then, what positive points this film did you enjoy, Beat? Real few off.
I'll give you some.
We know it's in the halls of Crasshalla.
Main point.
Uh-huh.
You have, on one hand, a solid plot. Really clean, really cut, never drags. Really lean piece of meat sizzling in that frying
Love
pan.
It.
A nice, juicy action film. Pair that with John McClane's characterization.
Yep.
Every character in the film's great. Solid performances from everyone. Fucking hell, Bruce Willis. What a fucking great guy. He's turned into an arsehole, but he really cared about film at the time he made this Bond.
Can I just tell you that I've seen Bruce Willis's penis?
Excuse me?
He did a fucking film, like one of the first films he did, like a B-movie type thing.
Yeah.
And I saw it ages ago, on like Channel 5 or something, and he goes swimming in the water, and he's got nothing on, and they like do a shot of like his dick in water.
Oh, alright then, fair play.
I tell you what it is, should we tag it, or should we not tag it?
No, definitely don't tag it. Can I make the joke?
Don't tag it.
I can get a joke out of this.
Okay, come on.
Bruce Willis.
Right, so what I liked about Die Hard...
Getting back my points. Great lean action film. Great characters, great actors and actresses. Mixed with this subtle storytelling, with the use of various visuals, such as strokes on the arm, bad guys noticing that he doesn't have footwear on, so they're shooting the glass. That's inventive. The kind of humanity of him. He's very vulnerable. It's ridiculous what he does in the film, but you always feel throughout it, if he takes one bullet, he's gone.
Yeah.
Do you get what I mean? Doesn't feel massively overpowered. No. I guess the vest, it's quite a vulnerability. He's not wearing body armour. He's showing his goddamn sleeves.
It's just an excellent film, Beat, really.
I love it, John. I love it.
What do I like about it?
It's set at Christmas.
It's definitely a Christmas film. It's got Germans as villains.
Of course we need it.
It's
Nazis.
Got a dude with no shoes on, in work slacks and a vest, taking people down. It's got multiple explosions.
Yep.
It's got helicopters that fly 10 foot above the ground.
Yep.
And it's got...
a black guy and a white guy with the same name.
Big Johnson, Little Johnson. It's got, the main thing at the end. Sergeant Al Powell in, who's one of my favourite characters of all time.
Yeah.
Is he one of your favourite characters, Beat, who's had the least screen time?
As in, what do you mean, like, afterwards?
He does not get a lot of screen time, by the way.
Oh, I thought the point you were making... And he's very memorable. I thought the point you were making is he's not seen in another film.
Well, he's not. Why doesn't he come back and do, like, a Lethal Weapon with Bruce Willis' name in?
Because that would be Die Hard. Not Lethal Weapon.
That's a good,
Mel Gibson.
That's a career point.
And Danny Glover.
Right, that
wraps... Shit!
That wraps it up, Beat.
Right.
So then, Peter, apologise for the late podcast this week. We've been very busy in the rundown for Christmas.
Bingo.
Finishing university, working, trying to do everything. We've got a bit of time off now, though.
A little bit.
So it should be okay. Are you excited, Beat, for next Friday? Oh, sorry, not next Friday. This Friday.
Boy, oh boy. It's the alignment of the moons and the suns, the planetary systems coming together, that time, which will only happen probably to another 15 times in my life. You know what it is, I know what it is. It's conglomerate Star Wars.
Yes, Disney Star Wars. People, we are off to see Star Wars on Friday, and that will be our next episode.
The machine that doesn't stop.
The Last Jedi.
Ooh!
I think this will be an adequate time beat.
Yes.
To talk about Star Wars.
Predictions.
The Last Jedi. And come up with some predictions. What are you thinking, Beat? You're a little bit clued up me because I've tried to avoid Twitter. I've tried to avoid YouTube. You've watched some prediction videos. You've watched all that. So what are you thinking?
Okay. Anything I say now may affect your experience of Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
Tune out if you want total blindness.
Yep.
These are our opinions based off information completely...
And seeing the last film, seeing the films before, this is just...
Completely on the trailers.
This is not spoilers.
No.
It could possibly be spoilers if we are Mystic Megs.
Exactly.
We don't know.
Exactly. So tune out now if you're scared, because these could come true. Probably not. First one, I really enjoy this. Rey is linked to Palpatine in somehow.
Hmm. How, Beat?
Who knows?
Actually, I've heard you say, Beat, you think Rey's linked to Palpatine because she javelins a lightsaber?
Yes. So someone made a really good video on YouTube, which I might link, if I can find it. The stance of her lightsaber form...
Yeah, because you've seen everyone's got different lightsaber form.
Yeah, there's like 7, right?
Yeah.
And apparently, if you kind of... She has like this forward jab.
Right, okay.
And that is only ever used on screen by...
And you were saying...
By Palpatine.
And you were saying a theme as well. It's yeah, very similar to Palpatine's
theme. This is in the video as well, where if you move it down one octave or some sort of sound, mimbo-jumbo musical term, it transforms into the Emperor Palpatine's theme, which is really interesting. Bit far-fetched.
See, I'm...
Definitely not going to do it.
I'm hoping, Beat, we get the double cross type thing.
Right.
Like the character arc's changing. So Rey turns bad.
Yeah.
And Kylo turns good.
Okay.
And then the final films, Kylo is the protagonist.
Yeah.
Trying to get Rey back on
side.
And the both of them face Snoke.
Right.
But then again, I can't see that happening because they've kind of eradicated that by him killing Han Solo. Him killing...
That's a far way to come back.
Him killing everyone at the Jedi Academy and burning it down, if that is him who did it.
Okay.
Maybe it's a double... Maybe it's a plot twist. Maybe he didn't do that.
So he's what...
Has that been actually confirmed that he was the one in the Knights of Ren who did that at the Jedi Academy? Or is it still ambiguous?
No, he definitely kind of led the Ren.
Right, okay.
I want to make a quick kind of prediction.
Mm-hmm.
What I want to happen. Not yep. What will happen. I'm going to say what I want to happen, then I'll say what will happen.
Mm-hmm.
I want to happen. Rey ends up somehow, at the last minute, killing Ben Solo or Luke to cross to the dark side and
right.
Siding with Snoke because she finds out she's related in some way. That would be perfect.
But because it's Disney film beat, it's not going
to
happen.
They're not going to... One, I don't want Luke to die just after Han's died. That I don't like
feeling. I don't think they'll kill Luke off. I don't think they will. What I'd love to see, Beat,
mm-hmm.
is her being turned by Snoke.
Right.
And Luke... being the main character going into the last film.
Right.
I think that would be interesting.
Right.
Obviously, to get I don't know, a quarter way through the last film, he manages to get Rey back on side or Kylo back on side.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's literally the three of them versus Snoke.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But then I'm not sure they'll do that because Luke's the most powerful Jedi in the universe, isn't he?
He is. I meant to be until Rey comes along.
Well, yeah.
And then the next film comes along who has a more powerful protagonist.
But yeah, people, hit us up on the Twitter. Let us know what you think or what you're expecting for the new Star Wars, and we're excited to see it.
Do you want quick main predictions?
You've given us them, but go again.
No, that's what I want to happen, not what will happen.
Main predictions,
this is what will happen.
You see, and speak on behalf of both of us, Pete.
Rey is going to turn to a grey Jedi in between light and dark.
Right.
100%.
So who's side she on?
Nobody's. Luke's probably going to die.
Oh, Norby, don't kill Luke off, please.
Is Snoke going to die? I don't know. Leia's going to survive. I don't think she'll be killed.
Right.
Is Kylo Ren going to change to the good side? Fuck. I have no idea. That's the worst prediction.
So, Beat, excellent predictions. Let's go into some fan questions.
Terrible.
Beat.
Mm-hmm.
The first fan question. We've got @TheHedgyGar. Adam Gar, people, give him a follow. on Twitter.
What a ledge.
He says, what would your action plan be to defeat Gruber if you were too fat to fit in the air vents? To be fair, that's a massive plot hole for the film. If you were fat, could you defeat him?
He's one for you.
Okay. How would you get around not being able to go in the air vent speed?
Oh, I've got it.
Okay.
What floor is Gruber on? He's on the floor with the hostages, correct?
30th floor.
Is McClane above them when he's in the vents?
McClane's above them, aye.
Go up the roof.
Okay.
Get the spool he gets, the fire hydrant
right,
hose.
Right, aye.
Go literally 4 floors above him.
Yes.
Smash the window.
Quick, and just come straight into his office.
SWAT dive, rappel in. Rainbow Six Las Vegas, upside down, headshot, dead. Terrorists fall apart, head of the snake chopped off, game over.
But I think you've solved Die Hard in 5 minutes.
Well done. Die easy.
Die easy, mate. Beat.
John.
At Bosk Bounty Hunt here.
Who is he?
Friend of the show, top man. Hi, Bosk from Bristol here. Alan Rickman was one of my favourite actors who ever lived. Out of an extensive back catalogue, what was his greatest role?
Oh my god. Not a Harry Potter fan.
A lot of people would say Harry Potter, mind.
Alan Rickman.
A lot of people would say Harry Potter. Everyone at university is massive about Harry Potter. I don't know why.
Fair
they're, like, they're like 10 years younger than me, like, to be fair, so that's probably the reason.
That is a fair assessment.
I'm a mature student, apparently.
List of Rickman films. Better than Die Hard?
I think... Bosk, I want to say this. Like, I want to say his portrayal of Hans Gruber.
For me, John, there's only one film that's better than Die Hard, which Rickman's been involved with.
Come on.
Galaxy Quest.
Wasn't that shit?
No, a lot of people like it.
Alright. What about Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves?
That's a great shout.
Unbelievable in that.
I want to. You know what? I say sadly, Die Hard, which is weird. As in, I feel an actor of his caliber hasn't had like a Oscar bait movie he's been better in.
Right.
A more kind of Daniel Day-Lewis career, if you want to put it in my terms.
He's a very, very, very good actor.
Die Hard for me.
Was he not very much an actor of the stage rather than like.
Possibly.
But then, to be fair, we've said it like there earlier, it's all about Harry Potter for him. That's his main. Would you say more people recognise him as Hans Gruber or Severus Snape?
No, Snape. Mm. That's changed though. Gruber was his identity, but yeah. For me, Die Hard, nothing beats it.
Right, Beat. Last question.
Yes, I.
From our friends at NTFTT Pod.
Uh-huh.
Give them a follow, Peter. Excellent podcast. Also, check out the Loosely Connected website. We're part of a worldwide podcasting network.
Let's go.
Which is amazing because we never thought we'd get there at so this soon. Moment of time. Met some great people. Met some other great podcasts. Got no opinions out there. Beat. What superhero would it be hilarious to hear say yippee-ki-yay? And in what situation? Do your best impression.
Of the superhero.
I think what you've got to pick the superhero. You've got to do your best superhero impression and see it be Kaye.
Okay.
Who would you pick?
I've gone for a little clever one here, John.
Come on, mate.
Black Bolt.
What?
Black Bolt.
Who the hell's Black Bolt?
He's an inhuman who can't speak because his voice is so powerful he can destroy the world.
So does that mean that you don't have to do an impression?
Well, he'd whisper it, I guess. So I'll go, yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker. There you go.
I've got a guy who, if John McClane was going to be an X-Man, he would probably be Wolverine.
Nice.
Yippee-ki-yay, bub.
Shocking. Absolutely dreadful.
I can't do impressions.
Right, I'm giving you another impression.
Right, come on.
People have got to guess which superhero I'm doing. I'll give a 5 second after I high in the okay. Impression.
Basically cracking up.
I can't get this out now.
Okay.
Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker. Not bad.
Not bad at all.
That is Jean-Luc Picard in a wheelchair. Professor X.
And that wraps up fan questions, people.
Logan, what's your power, Hot Wheels?
We've been recently putting out some film fights every other day. Well, really to go with the podcast.
Right.
I put out there, Beat, who would win the fight? John McClane versus Evan Hund.
Now, this is a no-brainer for me.
Right. It's in a building.
Yeah.
You've got to save Holly.
Holly Gennaro.
Yep. I'd like to say that Evan Hunt's a bad guy trying to stop you from saving Gennaro.
Wait,
so he needs to stop you for his mission. John McClane needs to get her and get her out. Who wins?
Evan Hunt.
Why?
He's got Ving Rhames and a van outside.
Well, I know, but McClane's got Powell. And also the dude in the limousine.
What's Powell going to do? Powell just eats Twinkies and reassures him. Oh, he shoots that guy at the end, to be fair. So are you telling me Powell drives his cop car into the van accidentally, traps Ving Rhames inside, and then pulls his revolver and shoots all of them, like, in slow motion?
Beat, it sounds good to me.
And what does Ethan Hunt do? See, though, Ethan Hunt wears a mask, right? He garrots Alf Powell, right? Takes his face, makes a mask out of it, becomes him, and then shoots Thingy in the back when he's not looking.
Oh, but Beat, it's one of them things where I really want John McClane to win.
Everybody wants
John
McClane
to win. It's like, I want RoboCop to beat Terminator.
It's a sign of a good film. Well, too bad RoboCop's got a goddamn fleshy mouthpiece, which Terminator could exploit.
Well, we've got the lovely Ellie Lily. New listener, I think.
More new
listeners. Give her a follow. Liliana Ray on Twitter.
Ray.
As in Star Wars Ray.
I get it.
I'm thinking McClane. He had to do it on his own, and Hunt would need a team behind him to break him out. I love that.
What's the rules? Has Hunt got a team? Because Ving Rhames is a big part. Ving Rhames,
right, okay.
is the bishop of the chessboard here.
No teams, it's just him and McClane.
Him and McClane? See, Hunt is like special agent.
McClane's relentless though, relentless.
McClane's a cop.
Did you see the damage McClane took?
Nah, but these are fucking idiots.
McClane's not an idiot though.
No, he's not, but Hunt can wear a mask.
Is McClane more intelligent than Ethan Hunt?
No.
Right, okay.
Not at all.
Okay, what am I trying to do?
He's got pluckiness, though. Okay. Pluckiness goes a long way.
Anyway, Beat, that brings an end to the podcast.
Cheers, mate.
Sorry for the late upload, people. Like I say, we've been busy. Hope you enjoyed our stuff. If you did enjoy our stuff, put on iTunes, leave us that sweet, sweet 5-star review. Makes other listeners come to the podcast.
Come to the party.
Also give us a follow on Twitter at Talking Crass. And we're on SoundCloud for Android users. Talking Crass as well.
Welcome to the party, pal.
I hope you've enjoyed it, people. I've been John.
It's been Beateronius.
We'll see you next time for Star Wars The Last Jedi.
What noise was that at the end?
Beat.
Aye.
It's a bloody nightmare. We need to get somewhere.
We need to get The Last Jedi screening.
There's no Ubers. There's no buses running. I wish there was someone who could pick us up. Bloody hell, Beat. Travelling style.
Argyle, I'm your limo driver.
Cheese Argyle.